Hachette Audio presents 20th Century Fox, Darryl F. Zanuck and the Creation of the Modern Film Studio. Written by Scott Eyman, read by Suehyla El-Attar. Introduction. Begin with the beginning. A vibrant drumroll announces what could be the arrival of an emperor come to inspect his subjects. The drumroll is more or less a lift from John Philip Sousa. Many of his marches start with the same riff, a fact that would have been obvious to audiences in the 30s when Alfred Newman first composed the music. The screen lightens to reveal a deco monolith that reads 20th Century Fox as searchlights sweep across the sky. As the drums finish, the brass kicks in, with a stentorian conclusion to the fanfare, rising to a final crash of percussion as the logo darkens to transition to the main title. The theme for the brass is in F major, and the score specifies that it be played majestically. As the composer Neil Brand says, it's a basic call to arms, Roman fanfare that doesn't move off its root note. It's a magnificent musical equivalent of the logo itself. Big, arresting, and at the same time graceful, holding the promise of something wonderful. Nearly 20 years after composing the original fanfare, Alfred Newman added another 8 bars, taking the piece to a loftier, more resolved plane. The addition was to herald a separate panel after the Fox logo, announcing that the film was shot in CinemaScope. Newman's addition meant that the fanfare resolved with a B-flat minor 6th, concluding on a triumphant F major final note. The original 8-bar fanfare and logo were created in 1933 for Darryl Zanuck's new company called 20th Century Pictures. When 20th Century merged with Fox Pictures in 1935, creating 20th Century Fox, that logo and fanfare introduced nearly every Fox film. Before Alfred Newman's fanfare, the introduction of the studio's films had been an unprepossessing polyglot. Sometimes it read, William Fox presents. Sometimes, Fox Film presents. But Newman's fanfare gave the studio an identity that lasted for more than 3/4 of a century, a vibrant signature that was revitalized in 1977 when John Williams and a huge orchestra re-recorded the complete 16-bar fanfare for Star Wars, if only because Williams had written the opening of his landmark score in F major as well. It was a hand across time from one great composer of film music to another, and it made the Fox trademark sound thrillingly new and modern. For more than 50 years of its existence, the Fox studio was dominated by two alpha males. First, William Fox, the founder of The Feast, a feral, single-minded character who saw himself less as a movie mogul and more as a vauntingly ambitious American legend in the making, a Jewish Vanderbilt. Then there was Darryl Zanuck, who combined Fox's company with his own and ran the result, said one of his stars, like a Swiss watch. Fox was born Wilhelm Fuchs in Hungary in 1879 and came to America when he was 9 months old. He grew up poor in the American equivalent of a shtetl, the Lower East Side of New York. There were 13 children in the Fuchs family, 7 of whom died young. Zanuck was born in Wahoo, Nebraska in 1902, and many people thought that in some primary way, he never quite grew up at all. Wahoo would prove far too limiting for a man of Zanuck's energies. He meant to put himself at the center of the whirlwind, and if he had to create the whirlwind himself, so much the better. As he told a gathering of his peers at the Screen Producers Guild, "I decided to become a genius, and being a genius, I had to live that way." William Fox single-mindedly built an empire of theaters and eventually began making movies in order to keep more of the money for himself. Money was Fox's armor, his status, the way he measured how far he had come on the path from poverty. He raised the level of his films incrementally from a production policy that schizophrenically flicked from a focus on mother love to blatant exploitation and back again until a flowering in the 1920s with some of the enduring classics of silent film: The Iron Horse, Sunrise, What Price, Glory, Seventh Heaven. It was only the unforeseen cataclysm of the 1929 stock market crash that destroyed Fox's plan to dominate the entire American movie industry. Zanuck was more or less indifferent to theaters, not particularly obsessed by money, cared only about movies, all kinds of movies, their construction, their making, their editing, their presentation. He devoured movies the same way he devoured life. Command was his prerogative. He would go on safaris. He would ride horses beyond the edge of danger. He would go to war. He would make love to beautiful actresses. Nothing else would do. And he would make more than 1,000 movies, some of them classics then and now: The Grapes of Wrath, How Green Was My Valley, My Darling Clementine, All About Eve. Under both men, Fox was a studio with innovation in its DNA. Fox never had a great deal of what you could call elegance. That would be Paramount. Or the most money. That would be MGM. Or the biggest stars. MGM, again. But you could make a serious case that, from the mid-20s on, it was the Fox studio that led the way creatively. William Fox placed his bet on sound on film. Whereas Warner Brothers placed the same bet on an inferior technology, a record running in theoretical sync with a 35mm projector. Because they were on the same drive shaft, if the film and record started out in sync, they would, presumably, stay that way. Unless the record skipped, or the film broke. The Fox system was obviously superior and became the industry standard within 3 years. At the same time, Fox invited the man he regarded as the world's greatest director to create a great film without regard to budget. F. W. Murnau made Sunrise, a masterpiece of mood and photographic ingenuity that won a special Oscar at the first Academy Award ceremonies. Fox placed another bet on 70mm widescreen. He produced several films as demonstration objects, including a Western epic titled The Big Trail, the film that introduced a young man newly christened John Wayne to the world. When the movie industry entered a post-war commercial trough caused largely by television landing with both feet, it was Zanuck and 20th Century Fox that brought widescreen out of the attic. This iteration was called CinemaScope, and the dozen competing widescreen processes that came after nudged the box office upward so that the industry could once again compete. When Darryl Zanuck took control of the Fox studio in 1935, many people thought he would attempt to replicate the success he had achieved as the production head at Warner Brothers, movies that were fast and tough, quick and dirty, and almost always urban. The stories that Zanuck put on the screen invariably involved people who had been places and done things. Sometimes they had been things and done places. Almost all of them were people in his own image, men and women who seized their piece of the world and dared anybody to take it away from them. Warners stocked their shelves with sleazy shysters, Warren Williams, and a profusion of streetwise mugs, James Cagney, Edward G. Robinson, who embodied male aggression as a prerequisite for survival, not to mention leading ladies, Barbara Stanwyck, Betty Davis, who matched up nicely with the men. What Warners put on the screen was matched by what went on behind the scenes. Harry Warner had a visceral dislike of anybody who made as much money as he did, and his brother Jack had the soul of a racetrack tout. Warners had directors such as the brusque Michael Curtiz, who didn't like actor bums, and Raoul Walsh, who wore an eye patch, for God's sake. "We're talking major tough guys here," wrote Ethan Morden, charged with bringing every film off with the efficient fury of a pirate raid. But Zanuck understood that times had changed. The production code had come into force midway through 1934, and movies exclusively centered on an intermingling of power, violence, and sex were no longer possible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.